Salam everyone, welcome to Mom Talk, and we are so happy to have you here today. My name is Roma Khetarpal. I am an author, a mom, and the founder of Tools of Growth, and I'm filling in today for Dr. Nelly Farnoody. We have a very special guest with us today. Susie Lula is a spiritual teacher, counselor, and a fabulous inspirational speaker, and she's an expert in the field of human transformation. She's been featured on the Today Show, and she stood beside renowned authors, best-selling authors, Dr. Shefali Zabari and Neil Donald Walsh and several others. So we are so happy to have Susie here. And what I would love to share with you as a start of the program is that her mission statement is live your life as a miracle. So Susie, welcome. It's a
Thank you so much. I'm so honored and grateful to be here with you.
Thank you. Thank you. So what I have not told everyone is that Susie is a renowned author. And of course, I'm having four vision in this, right? Her brand new book, The Motherhood Revolution, will be published in September. So we'll have a big launch for her in September, on September 22nd, I think.
Exactly.
You said, right? And so The Motherhood Revolution sends a beautiful message of how thriving mothers raise thriving children. And Susie, if I understand this correctly, and please feel free to jump in, you've started off with some fabulous endorsements on this book, right?
Yes.
You've got Dr. Shefali Zabari, who is, you know, the guru in conscious parenting.
Exactly.
She said that you are the lifeline for moms. Mm-hmm. So this is a wonderful message for moms to reach out to you. And of course, she wrote the foreword of your book.
She did.
Correct?
I'm very, very grateful and honored that she wrote the foreword to the book.
That's wonderful. And then Dr. Michael Beckwith,
yes,
who called Susie a transformational teacher, he wrote the introduction to the book. How amazing is this?
Very, very fortunate and grateful.
Oh, that's wonderful. And of course, how I met Susie was at in December last year at Evolve. It was a Conscious Parenting Summit. And Susie and I met, and I have to tell you, I'm going to share this with all of you. Susie was the closing speaker at this event, and it was a weekend event, so we were all, by the end of it, conscious parenting overload, right? And so this is right at the end. Parents are exhausted. She's the last closing speaker. And, you know, closing speakers are such an important part of, you know, weekend events. Mm-hmm. And Susie walked up on the stage and just took my breath away.
Oh,
she was absolutely fabulous. She came up and lit up. Our audience was about 300 people. And Susie came and just lit up the room with her message of self-care and motherhood. And I was so taken aback by her message. Susie, I really want to start with this introduction of the basics, really bringing in those basics into this conversation. What is self-care in relation to motherhood?
Yeah, excellent. Well, I think this is the question that we all have. I know for myself and for the women that mothers that I work with every day, you know, self-care is, well, I'll say the most basic definition I can give is self-care is nurturing ourselves and nourishing ourselves on every level. So we're nourishing ourselves on our physical level, our emotional level. We're nurturing and nourishing ourselves on the mental level. And most of all, we're nourishing and nurturing ourselves on the spiritual level. So when we think of self-care, we can sometimes in culture think that it's very selfish, and this is all part of what I'm passionate to change this paradigm from thinking that something would be selfish when we're actually talking about nourishing ourselves and most of all nourishing our spirit.
Right. And you talk about this in your book. You talk about how often mothers actually get disconnected from our very self when we have children.
Exactly.
Could you shed some light on that?
Well, exactly, because, you know, many times when we're pregnant or when if we're in the adoption process, you know, we are thinking about ensuring that we are at our best.
Right.
You know, especially a mom who is carrying a child, she is wanting to make sure that she's healthy and maybe talking to that child and, you know, so.
That's then, right. We do all right? of this conversation yeah. when we're pregnant.
And so we're very connected.
Yes.
And then when we have the child, of course, there are so many tasks involved with raising a child and especially an infant. They need us 24/7. And so we have this very intimate spiritual connection when we meet our child, whether adopting or a biological child. Typically, when we meet our child for the first time, it is a very connected spiritual connection.
Right.
And then often we get into the doing and the tasks that absolutely are called for from us, and we sever our own inner connection with our own spirit so easily and
yeah.
unintentionally.
That's so interesting. So when you're saying spirit, in Farsi the word is ruh.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that, obviously, because obviously we don't have the child yet.
Yes.
The child is within the feeling, within the body of the parent,
yes.
of the mom, of course. And that connection that you're talking about that we have during pregnancy is truly spirit to spirit.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
And so that's what you mean with the spiritual
yes.
connection
yes.
With the child, right?
Yes. And you can even think of it just a heart connection. You know, we look at, I look at any infant, and our heart just opens, any child, your heart just opens. So there's a connection when we look at a child and their innocence and their purity, and our heart opens.
Right.
And so we're connected to our heart. And then we get into the doing tasks.
So you say when we're pregnant, we have that heart connection open, we're open-hearted, and then once the baby comes, you know, in our arms physically,
yeah, yeah.
then we're scattered, right?
Because well, we become very child-centric then.
Right, that's right.
Child-centric.
And child-centric meaning we start, all the focus goes on
the child.
In the
yes.
care of the child, in the day-to-day, so many things, right? We could
sure.
start from the morning to
sure.
the evening and a mom
and you're
just
sleep-deprived. And,
yes.
and so with very, very good intention of caring for this child, we turn away from the most important thing within us, which is our heart and soul and spirit connection.
Right. And so we, in essence, going back to the question, we get disconnected
yes.
with our very selves because we are busy in the doing, in the tasks of motherhood.
Yes.
Wow. That's yes. very, very powerful. And, you know, oftentimes we don't realize that, right?
Exactly. It's so insidious. It's not, that's why I say it's not intentional. We're thinking we're here to serve our child and care for our child. And it is accurate that our children need us, then they need us to be very present in a heightened way. And so what I found is that it actually becomes more important for us to very consciously set intentions to stay connected to ourselves so that at least all of the doing and the caring for that we need to be doing with our kids can come from a place that we stay full.
Mm.
And most moms, you know, end up feeling exhausted and depleted and
right.
sleep deprived.
Yes,
and
of course, that's a
so
big one.
This is our challenge to stay connected to ourselves.
Wonderful. And you talked about intentions just a few minutes ago. Mm-hmm. You know, our intention as parents, you call it the highest intention in your book. So all of our intentions with our children are of the highest vision,
absolutely.
Right? We want our children to be successful and be happy and to be thriving with great character and good manners. And we could write a book on you know, what it is that we want for our children from this rite of parenting. Susie, if I were to ask you in one word, could you share with us what is it that the child is looking for with us?
Oh. Unequivocally, our children are looking for a connection to us.
Mm,
our child
connection.
Wants only and ultimately connection. Connection, connection, connection. Yes.
And would you define that for us?
Connection is the intimacy that is from heart to heart. When we feel, when I sense that you are present with me, that like you are right now, we are connected right now because I can feel your interest in me. You are present with me. You are not distracted.
So focused, basically focused on the task
yes.
at hand, on the child, making that, and I talk about
yes.
this in my book.
Yes.
You know, the chapter is called Sensible Parenting.
Yes.
Connecting our senses,
yes.
making that eye contact, listening word for word, right?
Yes. Yes. And this is what happens when we are disconnected inside of ourselves, then it becomes impossible to be connected and present in front of someone else, because we are disconnected. And that is why the heart of my work is about encouraging moms to know that it is far from selfish to be taking care of yourself. We think of it as, oh, I can't really take care of myself first because I have this being in front of me that needs me. And yet, if I'm disconnected from my own self, it's going to make it impossible for me to be present and connected. And what we all want, you know, you asked what our children want from us, which is connection. But I find in working, of course, with all of the mothers that I work with, ultimately, what is it that we want? We want to be connected to our children.
Exactly.
So we want
exactly.
the same
yes,
thing. And
yes.
our children want to be seen. Our children want to know that they matter and that they're important. And when I'm sure any of us, I can speak for myself, when I think back to what I wanted when I was a child, I wanted connection. I wanted to know that I was important and that I mattered, and I wanted someone to give me their present attention, their
absolutely,
focus,
absolutely.
Say.
And I have to tell you, you know, this is going back to what I talked about in our last show as well. I had discussed that what we are looking for as parents is a relationship
exactly.
with our children. We want that relationship because when all is said and done, it's really not going to matter what we did for them and all the things that we bought for them and all the things that we provided for them, the sports activities we took them to or the classes and the projects. What's going to matter is that relationship.
Of course.
And that relationship comes from this connection, if I
Absolutely.
Understand this correctly.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. So we're looking for that connection, and in that connection, being present in the moment to moment, being able to have ourselves centered. Now that's a really difficult task, and we'll go into some examples as we move along. That's a really difficult task because, you know, as moms, we have so much on our plate.
You bet.
We have things that have to be done. It's things that are not a choice, whether it's laundry or homework or bath or whatever it might be. These are actually not choices. These are necessities, right?
Yes. And I hear from mothers all the time, the number one challenge also is time.
Right.
Because we have all of these things to do, how am I going to find the time then to put myself, you know, up on the list, much less first on
right,
the list.
Right,
you know?
Right, right. And that's a really powerful point. How do I put myself on the list? So you have these to-do lists, right? And they're all based around the child. They're all, you know, what I need to do for my children. Where do I fit in?
Or for our homes, as you said.
Of course,
we have
of
grocery
course.
Shopping. We have laundry. We have to make dinner every day and breakfast every morning. So it
and we use our children as excuses for the most part because, you know, as women, we might say that, you know, we have to do the laundry for the children.
Yes.
We have to get the groceries for making dinner for the family.
Yes.
And so on and so forth,
yes.
right? So that's
yes.
our to-do list eventually is not something that we take satisfaction in.
Yes. And so this is why I have a saying that self-care is not for the faint of heart.
Oh.
Right? Self-care is not for the faint of heart because there is an element of courage, actually, to intend to put myself higher and higher and higher on my list until I really get to first place on my list. Because as you were sharing, our children are seeking relationship with us. They want to just relate to us, have a close, connected relationship to us. And so if we continue to keep ourselves off of the list and we're frazzled, we're not providing them ultimately. And as I say, you know, I'm not saying don't do the laundry, don't go to the market, but I am saying that I believe it is time for, first of all, we as mothers to galvanize ourselves and come together on this very, very important issue and topic. And in our own individual lives, to really take a moment and ask ourselves, are we truly providing for our child not what it is that we think that they need or want from us, but the place inside of us that they want this to come from? They want our heart. They want us, they don't want us to be frantic and frazzled, you know?
You know, and this reminds me of a beautiful quote that I had pulled up from Susie's book, so I'm sure all of you will enjoy this. This is again from the Motherhood
Evolution.
Thank you. When we treasure ourselves, we begin to speak more kindly to our children. children, have more empathy for their feelings, and experience a deeper connection with them.
Yes, so you think of that idea of treasuring yourself. You know, we treasure our children. You just look at your child. We treasure our children, yes. But to treasure ourselves. And as we were speaking earlier about self-care, you know, and how it ties into this, so most of us, when we first think of the concept of self-care, we think, oh, it's selfish. And I have come to know that actually self-care is the most selfless thing we can do. And it's actually very selfish. And actually,
so I was going to say that. I said, can you define that difference of being selfish and selfless?
Yes, and selfish and self-care, because actually what I found in working with mothers and also in my own home, the less I take care of myself, the more disconnected I am, and then actually the more narcissistic I am. Because I need do nothing more than walk into a room, and I need not even say a word, and my husband and my son can feel me.
Right.
They can feel me upset. They can feel me exhausted. They can feel me, you know, grumpy and not in a good mood. And just in my, you know, energy of walking in, they're kind of walking on eggshells,
right.
And, you know, they don't
want to
upset me.
So this is like, for example, the vibes, right? It's
yes.
the vibes that we give out.
Yes.
Because we could all walk into a room and see somebody and say, you know, that person's really cold.
Yes.
Or I got this, you know, the room.
A feeling.
Exactly. It's
yes.
a feeling. Okay. Okay, so
feeling.
We emit almost an aura
yes.
when we have nurtured our spirit.
Yes, and that aura, that energy that we, you know, comes before me in my house, and my poor son is then trying to walk on eggshells, you know, that I consider that, and I have learned that that is actually narcissistic, because then everything is revolving around me.
So it's self-centered is what
it's
you're
self-centered,
saying.
It's self-centered, exactly.
I see.
So self-care allows us to fill up our own tank so that then I am actually able to focus on my child, but from an overflowing tank.
But then that's also self-centered, right? We could look at that as also being self-centered.
Yes.
Right? So what is that fine line?
Yes. You want to look at the difference between which self you are feeding. I'm not talking about, you know, feeding this small self and going out and having a glass of wine every night and getting my nails done. I'm talking about feeding, as we were speaking at the beginning, my heart, my spirit, my life so that it overflows onto the life of my child, because he's going to, all of our children, what they're really picking up is the atmosphere in our home.
Right, absolutely,
you know?
Absolutely, yes. So it's interesting you bring that up, because mm-hmm. what I'm reading is that you're advocating a shift in the focus from self-sacrifice to self-care.
Absolutely.
And now that's a big one in our cultures. Huge. Because no matter which way you look at it, you know, self-sacrifice is just attached to motherhood. It is part of
yes.
the definition.
Yes.
She's a great mom because she does so much for her children.
Yes.
She's an excellent parent because she thinks of her children first. And
yes.
so you're advocating the opposite of that.
I'm advocating exactly the opposite.
Ooh,
this
Susie,
is
that's
the
a
heart
big one.
Of my work, because actually, you know, the actual definition of the word sacrifice means to make sacred.
Oh, wow.
The actual definition.
You know, I'm a big word nerd,
so, yeah.
right? My entire book is
yeah.
about breaking up those words
yes.
and seeing what's behind them. And I had
yes.
never thought of that.
The actual word, and that's why I say our intention, we are good, well-intentioned. Right? So we are intending to be of service to our children. We're intending to make sacred this relationship. And so unknowingly to us, and you know, we're not meaning to, unintentionally, we end up depriving ourselves, thinking that we're depriving ourselves in service to our child.
Right.
But actually what happens is we're depriving ourselves, and we cannot be the moms that we want to be when we're empty.
Right.
You just can't be exhausted and connected at the same time.
So I really love this connection that you have made between sacrifice and sacred. You know, we think that
yes.
Sacrificing, the self-sacrifice is an act of selfishness.
Yes.
But in essence, when you sacrifice for your kids. You're, so this is sort of that very fine gray area again, right?
Yeah.
Is self-sacrifice a sacred act? Or through self-sacrifice are we being compelled to do the opposite?
When we sacrifice ourselves for someone else, mm-hmm. we empty ourselves. Uh-huh. We deplete ourselves. Mm. So when I am constantly, when it's all going in one direction, and I'm doing the laundry to the deprivation of feeding myself, and I'm feeding someone else first to the deprivation of myself.
You're depleting yourself.
I'm depleting myself. I end up in a place of lack. I end up in a place of emptiness. I end up in a place of disconnection through the very actions that I think and what culture and society, you know, bestows like the crowns upon
yes,
us.
She's
the
exactly.
most, you know, she sacrifices the most, you get the biggest crown.
She's a good mother, right?
She's
right?
The good
we
mother.
Say she's a good mother,
but
exactly.
But inside, what I know is because I'm talking to these mothers every day, and they're not inside of themselves. They're not overflowing, and they're not proud to wear the crown because they're empty.
It's exhausting,
It's exhausting. Any one of us can know that. It's exhausting, and it's not meant to be this way.
Ugh.
And so
we are the ones
that have put it backwards, because I'm not implying to take care of ourselves to the, you know, detriment of our child,
sure.
to the neglect of our child. No,
right,
quite
right,
to the
right.
contrary. You know, no mother would ever want to go take care of herself and then neglect her child.
Exactly.
Right?
I agree.
It's proven that those with the most vitality are the ones to always assist people first.
Yes.
So I like to think of moms almost as philanthropists, because if I can have the most energy, I'm going to be the first person to give.
Right. I love that. If I can have the most energy, then I can be the first person to give.
Yes.
And since my job is giving,
yes.
then I need to make sure that my energy,
yes.
my spirit, my ruh, as we call it in Farsi, is replenished, is feeling good, and is actually nourished.
Yes.
Right. So, Susie, are you advocating that we need to lower the bar for motherhood?
Absolutely. Unequivocally, another, you know, oh my gosh, she's saying lower the bar. I'm saying lower the bar on public television.
Right.
And yes, I am, because I believe that we don't take the time to really delve into the belief system of what makes a good mother. And so we're buying into this cultural belief system without ever really slowing down and choosing what really makes the mother that I am here to be. It is certainly not coming from some kind of empty tank. This is not going to get us to be the moms that we are really here to be.
So let me ask you this question,
yes.
all right? And we're on TV here, so this is great to share with such a large audience. What or how would you define a good mother?
That's a great question. So first of all, I think we should just throw out the word good. Right? I want to be a connected mother.
There you go.
Right?
There you go.
I want to be a vital mother. I want to be a joyful mother. I think we first and foremost need to choose carefully the adjective.
I love this. This is why it was so important for me to have Susie here, because within conversation, we've had many of these conversations, even last night when we were talking about, you know, what are the things that we'd like to share with our audience. This is what she's an expert at, is redefining certain dogmas, if you will, that we have about motherhood.
Yes, this is my passion. I seek to redefine the way we look at motherhood, redefine the choices that we're making. You know, we all just buy into, I want to be a good mother, but really, I want to be a connected mother.
Because that's what our child needs.
Exactly.
So we've walked through these steps of what is self-care in relation to motherhood, what do our children really need? So we're creating this nice timeline of understanding, if you will.
Yes.
And now here we come to this big one where in a culture, in a society of self-sacrifice, in connection to motherhood, you know, it's what I do for my children first.
Yes.
We're shifting the focus. And yet not to the point where we're neglecting our children. That's not the message here. The message is to be able to fill your tank, if you will. And I know you talk about this running on empty in your book as well.
Yes.
So be able to fill your tank so that we can give to the children. So it's that fine balance. And now this is a big one, right? No more good mother.
Yeah, exactly.
Connected mother.
Yes.
And that's the one
yes.
thing that we should all take pride and honor in is being that connected mother. I love that.
Yeah. Thank you.
I love that.
Yes.
That was my big aha moment I just had thinking, you know, we have this word, I'm a good parent, I'm a bad parent. So in essence, if I were to break that down and flip it, so a good parent is a connected parent, if I were to look at society, you know, standards, if you will.
Yes.
And when we feel like a bad parent, we're feeling that because we're disconnected.
Yes, exhausted, overwhelmed. And so we can't actually, you know, connect and do the very thing that we're so seeking to do.
Answer,
it seems so obvious. It seems so cliche, you know, you hear on any flight, right? It's the cliche of put your own oxygen mask on first.
Right.
Now, when you hear that coming on a flight, you never think, oh, the person's going to put their oxygen mask on and then be selfish.
Right.
And not help anyone else.
Sure,
you would
sure.
never think that.
That's true.
You
That's
know
so true.
That
yeah.
if I put my oxygen mask on, it allows me to assist my child even
yes.
more. So why do we have this just on us. On a flight. So now it is, that's why I say it's not for the faint of heart, because it is going to involve changing some of our values, changing some of our
I think
of our
more
dynamics.
Than anything else, changing our habits.
Changing
right?
our habits.
Not just our external physical habits, but our internal
dialogue.
Thought processes,
Process, exactly.
right? Our dialogue. And in my last session here with Mom Talk, we talked about that internal communication landscape.
Yes.
And so you're talking about really changing that dialogue, changing that internal communication landscape so that we can have that have an effect on our children.
Yes.
And again, what I love about what Susie's saying here is that we should focus on the child in not what we're doing for the child, but focus in the connection.
Yes.
So that's
how I'm showing up for the child. How I am showing up for my child. So when I take better care of myself, the way I show up for my child is different than when I don't. And to use a really practical example, let's just say, so let's say my son comes to me and I'm feeling disconnected or I'm exhausted and I'm speaking to him and I'm impatient and I'm getting ready to lose my temper and I don't want to, but this is what's happening
I'm
impatient.
Exactly,
You know, the first thing that I do is say to him, I need a minute. The first thing I say to him, so when you're speaking of my internal dialogue, you know, I go to my own internal dialogue first.
Because as moms, we tend to jump in to resolve things and to solve things and just jump in. But really, if we have the heaviness of emotions and tiredness or whatever it might be, whether it's on the emotional level, intellectual level, if, you know, we've been at work all day, whatever the situation might be, the idea is to take that step back.
Yes.
And this is exactly what I want to get in next, is to ask you some real life examples that mom can use for applying this self-care in nurturing our own spirit and bringing our best, because when we nurture our spirit is when we bring our best forward, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. You can feel it. Like you said earlier, you can feel someone when you walk in a room and they feel a little cold or disconnected. You can feel someone whose heart is open, and our children are just looking for mom with an open heart.
There
you
go. It's, and that's what makes the connection.
That's what makes the connection.
Yes.
And you can feel it.
So I was reading in Dr. Sandra Barrett's work, mm-hmm. it's called The Secret of the Cells. This is just recently, you're familiar with that work, obviously. And she talks about how our entire body language changes when our heart is closed. And she talks about the heart centers. And I'd listened to one of her talks as well. And so if we notice and really pay attention when we are tired, when we are upset, we just tend to slouch and we do this. And this is our heart center and this is what ends up closing.
Absolutely.
So you're advocating taking that step back.
Absolutely.
And really taking a deep breath, taking some sips of water, whatever it might require for you to take, for us to take as moms, so that we can bring that best self forward.
And as you were saying, you know, this involves really changing our habits, because I'm really speaking of a way of life. I'm really speaking of shifting a paradigm and a way of life from being child-centric to really being mother-centric, which sounds, that can sound selfish, but I'm standing in and advocating, and I promise and I guarantee unequivocally, if you practice this for just a month of your life, 1 month, and you say, I'm going to just try this and prove it out, I absolutely guarantee you on the very first day that you do something to connect with your own heart, your own spirit, I guarantee you, you walk back into your home differently, you walk and you communicate with your child differently, and you feel good about who you are.
Yeah, so this brings a really important question to mind. I was listening to one of Susie's talks at the Spiritual Center in Orange County, and in that you say that we teach what we need to learn. So obviously you've written a book, right?
Yes.
So talk to us about how this started for you.
What a great question. Yeah, we teach what we most need to learn. So I'm my biggest student, right?
Yeah.
So for me, it started as a child, really, because my mom, we tease, is the queen of martyrdom. My mom is the queen of self-sacrifice. And my mom intending to do a good thing for us. She was seeking
with good intentions, because we all have good intentions.
She deprived herself at every corner. And so the very thing that I was so seeking from her, which was to be connected with her, she was not available to me because she was exhausted.
Right.
You know,
and that's a common syndrome for all moms, right?
Yes.
We all feel that when we've given too much, we feel depleted,
and resentful,
and we get angry faster, and we lose, you know, lose that connection with ourselves.
Yes. So this happened to me, and when I became a mother, then I really did step back and begin to really research my own belief systems around motherhood and most of all, just the way I wanted to be present in my home, and consequently or simultaneously working with clients all day and mothers, and realizing that I was not alone.
Right.
That, many, many, many mothers are having the same experience. They want so desperately to be connected to their children, and they're anything but.
Because when we get disconnected, and let's talk about that road, like when we get disconnected from our children, when we are what we call a bad parent, it's because emotionally we've had an outburst, we've reacted to them, we've done something that makes us feel bad.
Absolutely.
And so with this disconnection, if I understand correctly, this pathway that we're drawing, with this disconnection comes the guilt, comes the doubt, comes the I'm a bad parent, I'm not a good enough parent, and all those feelings that are, that weigh so heavily on us, all those feelings that break us down and actually, in essence, make us lose our parental confidence in that connection with the kids, correct?
Yes, I have this saying from working with so many mothers, right? That there isn't a day goes by that a mom doesn't tell me that she feels guilty when she takes care of herself, or she feels guilty
that
when
she doesn't take care of herself.
Mothers have ourselves in this double bind,
right?
And what I'm suggesting is, yes, when we get into these same habits where, you know, into when are you going to do your homework and when are you going to take a shower, or with younger children, you know, it's all about the behavior and this and that. When we find ourselves, you know, we have to brush our teeth, we have to get to bed on time, and it's these habitual, you know, conflicts and challenges that are happening, I am suggesting that the very thing that is missing is the mother.
Mm.
And the mother being connected inwardly in the way that she would like. So you take such a practical example, let's say you have a child, my son's 13. So let's say, you know, after dinner, I think, you know, I have the laundry, I have to do the dishes, I have X, Y, and Z, you know, I have to get him everything prepared for camp tomorrow. I do have all of these things on my plate, right?
And these are real issues that we have.
Real issues. So I might tell myself, well, I really don't have time to go take a run. I really don't have time to go take a walk, right?
So I'm going to take a step back here and I'm going to ask you to give me the top three or four examples with your experience as a mom and also your experience as a counselor. Mm-hmm. You know, those top three or four examples where moms can nurture themselves, because I'll tell you, when I speak for myself, I was a very young mom. I was married at 20. I had my daughter at 23. And I don't think I understood that concept of taking care of myself.
Right, right.
And I had to actually, a few years later, dig deep into what is it that nurtures my spirit and nurtures my soul?
Yes. So you're asking two important and different questions. So let me just complete with the other. So let's say your mom, you have plenty of things to do after dinner. Something inside of you is saying, oh, I just want to go for a run. But you say, I really can't go for a run, right? I have too much to do. Then what's going to happen is you're going to stay in that same challenge with your child about homework, about showering, about bedtime. I'm suggesting that if you go take that run for 20 minutes, I'm not talking about, you know, 3 hours, 20 minutes, I will absolutely guarantee you that you'll walk back into your home after 20 minutes and you will be a different person.
Mm.
You will feel different, so you will relate to your child differently around that
home. So it's about finding that something that nurtures your spirit, whether it's a run, if you used to paint or be an artist or music. By the way, Susie is an award-winning pianist and she's a composer, so music in your case. So it's about finding that balance. Well, thank you, Susie, because I think that really, really helps. And I really want to quote one of my favorite quotes from your book. A mother's inner climate becomes the overarching climate of her children's lives.
Mm-hmm.
I love that. Mm-hmm. We often forget that inner climate is that we have by osmosis gets transferred into our children.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, Susie, in light of what has happened last week, I really want to talk about the senseless Orlando shooting, where we had so much loss of life and it was just absolutely baseless and senseless. And you talk about in your book that for mothers to thrive is to change the world. Those who wear the hood of the mother have the first imprint on their children and therefore the greatest imprint on society. Could you please shed some light on that?
Yes, thank you. And you know, such an important question.
Yeah.
So when you think of the nucleus, when I just think of my life with my son, your life with your children, anyone watching with your children, we have the greatest imprint because this is the most intimate relationship we're going to have. This is an intimate relationship. So this relationship bears the most intimacy and the richest contribution.
Yes, and
right?
So we leave this imprint on our children, and then obviously this goes into society. And when senseless acts like the Orlando shooting happen, we can't help but draw a connection back to this environment. We can't help but draw a connection back to perhaps parenting, the upbringing, and all of that. So you're right, I completely get that. And since we're almost at the end here, and Susie, this is so hard, right, to wrap up this show. I really want to ask you, I know you have a very special day you have a very special message for fathers. Father's Day is around the corner. Would you please share that with us?
Yes, so first of all, happy, happy Father's Day.
Yes.
And I believe because, you know, my book is about evolving motherhood, I so believe that we have so much to learn from fathers. And in this area around self-care that we've been speaking of today, I believe that fathers, they're not indoctrinated in the same way that we are around sacrifice, and they actually really take care of themselves for the most part. This is more of a female, a
that
woman.
That is so true. Right? You know, fathers are really good at self-care.
They
then.
Are. Yeah. They come home from work, they can change their clothes, they take their time, they take their moments so that then when they greet their children,
so
you know,
true. They I never thought of that.
They do yeah. this. They don't bear the cultural imprint that we
yes,
have.
Yes, the baggage, the cultural baggage.
Yeah. So I have learned, you know, before I started taking care of myself, my husband might go take a nap in the middle of the day and I would sort of roll my eyes like, I can't believe it. And now I really recognize that I have learned so much from him. And I believe that we as women and mothers, we have this to learn from fathers.
So you know, this is awesome because this gives us really that segue into wrapping this up and really thanking fathers
yes.
on Father's Day for
yes.
their wonderful contribution
yes.
and asking fathers to perhaps support moms when they do take that step back and be empathetic. And for moms, reach out to dads. The perfect day to ask for a goodie bag, a return gift from the fathers on Father's Day would be exactly this, is you have to support me as I learn, because this is a journey we are learning, as I learn to take that step back. So Susie, thank you very much. It was such a pleasure and such an honor to have you here. I wish you all the best on your journey forward, and we hope to have you back on our show.
Thank you. I would love that. I'm so grateful to have been
you.
Here.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So here we are, you know, talking about how we can refine motherhood with this simple yet clear understanding. When we nurture our spirits, how we actually are able to give more of ourselves to our children and to our families. So all of you moms out there at Mom Talk, please always, always keep that in mind. And Pierre Corneille says this best. He says, self-love is the source of all other loves. Mm. So keep that in mind as you move forward on your parenting journey, because this is the most important job you'll ever do, sometimes the hardest job you'll ever do, and if we're lucky, the longest job you'll ever do. And you need yourself to do this job well. So thank you so much for joining us, and Khuda Hafiz.
A child, before life removed all the innocence, my father would lift me high and dance with my mother and me, and then spin me around till I fell asleep. Then up the stairs he would me, and I knew for sure I was loved. If I could get another chance, another walk, another dance with him, I'd play a song that would never, ever end. How I'd love, love, to dance with my father again. Ooh. When I and my mother would disagree, to get my way I would run from her to him. He'd make me laugh just to comfort me, yeah. Then finally make me do just what my mama said. Later that night when I was asleep, he left a dollar under my sheet. Never dreamed that he would be gone from me. If I final glance, one final step, one final. she loved. I know you don't do it usually, but dear Lord, she's dying to dance with my father again. Every night I fall asleep, and this is all I am.